Well, thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you all for coming in on this beautiful spring evening when you might be doing something outdoors. And to say thank you to Chris, I'm going to read the couple of pages about him from the book towards the end of the talk. This book was published actually 10 years ago. It had some quite nice reviews, but it never went into paperback. It has was absurdly highly priced. And I still agree with most of what I wrote, but it's not in fact a very pleasant experience rereading something one wrote 10 years ago, I find. I don't know whether other people share this view. It's the subject is so broad, it splits off into so many different topics that I can't possibly do justice to the topic this evening, but I'll try and draw attention first to some very basic points that the book was trying to get over. Then I will look in detail at what I call the criteria for definition of religion, and then some case studies, but ending with anthropology and archaeology and the relationship of these two to religion, or some of the relationship of them to religion. Now, religion can be defined either very restrictively, as is probably more normally the case, or very broadly, and I've chosen the latter course. The key point is that religion is a folk concept, which academics have tried to turn into an analytical concept, an emic concept, which has ambitions to be an etic concept. Some people say this is not feasible at all, but I think it is worth doing if we adopt a fuzzy or polythetic definition of religion. This was an idea, I think it goes back to Wittgenstein, but also to Rodney Needham and Martin Southwell, who were two anthropologists. Martin Southwell particularly wrote an article in the 70s arguing for a polythetic definition of religion. That is, you cannot actually define it in one-to-one terms, because some religions or philosophies will fall outside a normal ethnocentric definition. For instance, Buddhism does not believe in a supreme being, but it would be folly to say that Buddhism was not a religion. But basically, the criteria whether a belief system qualifies as religion or not is a political matter. A clear example of this being Scientology, which fulfills many of the criteria for what I would call a strong field religion, because it was exactly what Ron Hubbard set out to do. It's an amalgam of psychoanalysis, science fiction, and Dharmic or Asian religions in a sort of molded into a great mess, which has been very convincing to people, and as a number of film stars have adopted it. And the House of Lords, that they're now called the Supreme Court of the UK, has actually decided that it is a religion and that people can have a valid marriage in a Scientology chapel. The members of the House of Lords, of the Supreme Court, I think are rather illiterate about the anthropology or philosophy of religion, not just think that religion is a private matter, it's not verifiable, and therefore the claims of whether something is religion or not is somewhat arbitrary. But actually, what this means is that Scientology is going to be able to take advantage of the tax breaks given to religious charities, and this has happened already in the United States. Another key point that I'd like to make is the importance of what has been called rather pompously methodological agnosticism. That is, one treats religious beliefs with respect but without commitment. I'm much more comfortable talking with social scientists about religion than with theologians, because they can always lay down an ace, that is God, to clinch an argument. But social scientists can have a dialogue with religious people. One can try to enter the life world of adherents of a religion, and one can have a dialogue with them up to a certain point. Of course, if you extend the definition of religion to cover other ideologies, this becomes much more difficult, because I would contend that Nazism and communism were political religions, as a lot of other people have argued. I've been influenced by the late Alfred Gell's idea that our technological society is haunted by irrationality or magic. He wrote about the technology of enchantment, which includes, crucially, mind control, advertising, and PR. especially ways in which people feel they can get something for nothing. Now, this includes most of the things that make life worth living for most of us, including the arts and creeds, but also all the mechanisms, short of brute coercion, by which we can be enslaved. Now, Alfred Gell wrote that it's better to submit willingly to enchantment, protecting ourselves from enslavement by means of playfulness and humour. And I would go along with that. Joseph Conrad, the novelist, said that life had to be a judicious choice of illusions, which I think was a great statement, but I would rephrase this as the need for a judicious choice of addictions. There is a religious inclination which we cannot repudiate, we can only choose how to channel it. I think one could adopt a hydraulic model that this religious inclination, when put under pressure, finds new outlets. If religious studies had originated in China rather than in the West, then possibly Confucianism or Taoism would have been the baseline for definition of a religion. Some people say Confucianism is not a religion, but actually it holds that everything in the universe is made of the same vital substance of qi, and this, to my mind, puts it on a par with other religions. But in China, Christianity was taken as the baseline, and for most of Western religious studies, Christianity is also taken as this baseline. Since I wrote this book, there's been a huge outburst of publications about religion. There are journals devoted to religious markets and rational choice theory and religion. A lot of anthropologists write about religion, and Christianity was almost neglected by anthropologists except in Africa. African Christianity has always been a popular subject, but Western Christianity almost ignored until the last 10, 15 years, when there's been a lot published, Fenella Cannell and others. Now, what I've suggested is a list for a polythetic or fuzzy definition of religion, various criteria for defining a religion. And they are in no particular order, because one of the most important ones, which is patina, that the fact has been there for a long time, comes at the end. First, an appeal to supernatural entities. But there are many cases of individuals who've been divinized during their lifetime. Roland Littlewood has written about the case of the first emperor of independent Haiti, Dessalines, and then Papadoc Duvalier, who were actually divinized by their people. And the cult of personality in communist countries, I would say, has definitely promoted certain individuals to the role of being a quasi-supernatural entity. One could argue that in our celebrity-dominated culture, people like David Beckham have almost reached this status. Secondly, an appeal to an ideal world is something very common in religions. Arguably, the most powerful feeling of attachment across all cultures is the child's attachment to the mother. And so the loss of the original sense of unity with the mother as an irrecoverable reality is a universal experience which religion and the arts try to recover throughout our lives. The charms and amulets, and in industrial cultures, key rings or fridge magnets that are widespread all over the world, may be thought of as mentally retaining what psychoanalysts call the transitional object, the blanket or stuffed animal to which young children, after weaning, become emotionally attached. In a higher register, the philosopher Charles Taylor writes of the sense of fullness or richness, the sense that life is more than it should be, something we just catch glimpses of from afar off. Thirdly, totalizing discourses, creeds, master dogmas, and scriptures. This is fairly common, I wouldn't say universal, but very common if you want to arrive at a definition of religion. Just a little point here about the prestige of books. The anthropologist Raymond Firth tells how he was asked in 1952 by one of the so-called pagan chiefs of the remote Tikapia Island in the Western Pacific, where Christianity had been making inroads for some decades, about the view that after death the souls of pagans were lowered into fire. The chief was pleased to hear from Firth that according to many modern Christians, this was only a traditional story of a figurative kind. Ah, said the chief, so it's just a lie. I thought it must be true as it was written in a book. Fourthly, ontology, or an explanation of human beings' place in nature. This, again, is a huge topic, but I would say it is one of the most common criteria that one could adduce. And here one should mention that doctrines of transmigration are extremely common, have been extremely common all over the world. And this one could argue that this was a kind of adumbration of evolutionary theory. I think that this would be an interesting idea to pursue. And indeed, the American 19th century essayist Emerson attempted to fuse a belief in transmigration with pre-Darwinian evolutionary theory, though he never came to terms with Darwinism itself. I can't resist here quoting a remarkable passage from Proust's A la recherche du temps perdu, translated into English, where he shows that the routine experience of deep sleep and reawakening is actually very close to the experience of esoteric mysticism, though it's something we all encounter almost every day. So I'm just going to read this paragraph. Suddenly I was asleep. I had fallen into that deep slumber in which are open to us a return to childhood, the recapture of past years, of lost feelings, the disincarnation, the transmigration of the soul, the evoking of the dead, the illusions of madness, retrogression towards the most elementary of the natural kingdoms. For we say that we often see animals in our dreams, but we forget almost always that we are ourselves then an animal deprived of that reasoning power which projects upon things the light of certainty. We present, on the contrary, to the spectacle of life only a dubious vision, destroyed every moment by oblivion, the former reality fading before that which follows it, as one projection of a magic lantern fades before the next as we change the slide. All those mysteries which we imagine ourselves not to know, and into which we are in reality initiated almost every night, as we are into the other great mystery of annihilation and resurrection. So that, I think, suggests that mystical experiences are in fact not something confined to very special people. Foundation narratives, this refers to the origins of the religion itself, not to the origin of the universe, but to how the religion itself arose through the arrival of particular prophets or other innovators. Conversion experiences are very common in religious, the history of religions, not absolutely universal, because many people inherit religion from their parents. There's a lot of transmission of religions through coercion and indoctrination. But there's also the experience of conversion is documented very widely all over the world. The acceptance of doctrinal paradox, this is what theologians call a mystery, but in fact there are nearly always tremendous contradictions in religions. The idea that the Christian or the Islamic God can be both unknowable and all-knowing and wholly good, and yet able to intervene at will in human affairs. This would be called a mystery, but it could also be called a paradox. The similar paradox of nirvana in Buddhism. The relationship between the Quran and Allah and God in Islam. And I would suggest also this is not just confined to religion, but any, if you think at all about existence in general, there are huge philosophical difficulties. The idea of the infinite is riddled with philosophic holes, as exposed in Cantor's Transfinite Mathematics, and as is the idea of pure logic, which was subverted by Gödel's theorems. So I think no theory about the ultimate nature of creation can be ruled out until science comes out with some convincing answers. There are some scientists who believe that in 100 years they will know everything about the universe. but we have to wait and see. It's even been hypothesized that we're all living in a computer simulation. Our next ceremonies, rituals, and spiritual disciplines. This is pretty obvious. Of course, ritual is not confined to what are generally called religions, because it's very common in military and political institutions of various kinds. The Quakers, interestingly, try and remove ritual as much as possible for their meetings. They have no ritual in the strict sense, except that a Bible is placed on a table with chairs placed round it. And the meeting is deemed to begin as soon as one person enters the room, and much of the meeting takes place in a meditative silence. However, the silence itself is a form of ritual. Just as all musicians know that silences or rests are invaluable as part of a musical repertoire, and the musical authority of conductors may be measured by how long their raised baton is able to hold an audience's silence after a concert, after the performance's final chord. Every individual is held by Quakers to be able to find in the silence a divine light within himself or herself, directly inspired by God. Solace in the face of suffering and death. Some people have said that this is the absolutely basic foundation of religion, that we all want to be comforted by that there'll be something after death. Martyrdom, a very frequent theme in the history of religions, though obviously in Christianity and Islam, though in different ways. Whole nations have embraced the ethos of martyrdom, one of the prime examples being Catholic Poland, whose sufferings under both Nazism and Soviet communism justified its self-image as the Christ among the nations, or indeed Christ crucified between the two robbers, the Nazis and the Soviets. Contemporary religions have their martyr nations too: Israel for Jews, Palestine, Bosnia, Kashmir, and Chechnya for Muslims, Tibet for Lamas, Buddhists, and their sympathizers outside, worldwide. And for the Dalai Lama, there are citizens of a virtual Buddhist state that he presides over all over the world, which is spiritually encircling China. Demonology. Perhaps the prevalence of suffering is the hardest stumbling block for all theologies. A belief in evil spirits is extremely widespread, and in traditional pagan religions usually operates at a local and practical level. The Hebrew Bible, by and large, relieves God of the responsibility for evil by positing the existence of bad angels. God does not distribute good and evil directly, but allows the chief of the bad angels, Satan, to do evil as a test, and he also allows Satan to tempt human beings. So the Jewish conception is really a kind of qualified semi-dualism, whereas in fully dualistic systems like Manichaeism and Zoroastrianism, the universe is governed by conflict between good and an autonomously evil force. Sin is often said to have disappeared from the lexicon of contemporary Christianity, but in the early summer of 2007, the Anglican Bishop of Carlisle, the Right Reverend Graham Dow, speculated that floods in the north of England could be God's punishment for the government's passing of the Civil Partnership Act that gave rights to homosexual couples. So it's obviously not gone completely. Moral imperatives based on altruism. This is, again, something extremely common, possibly not absolutely universal, and the internalization of a moral code through the idea of conscience, which Freudians would call the superego. And there's an analogy between the idea of confession in the Catholic Church and the psychoanalytic therapy, though very much disputed. Sectarianism is obviously not common to not confined to religions, but is extremely every religion seems to split into divisive sects inevitably. Identity politics. Some argue that splits in the Muslim world today between Shia and Sunni are entirely due to politics and ethnic identity rather than to religious doctrine. This is a very controversial matter, but something that can be discussed. The sacred-profane distinction of which anthropologists in the line of Durkheim have made great play, but I think it's would be agreed by most anthropologists that this is something very specific to certain religions. It certainly doesn't apply in Buddhism so much, because in Buddhism you don't have this sharp division between sacred and profane. I've argued myself that the following Mary Douglas, that the idea of the quest for purity is a genuine cultural universal that you can find everywhere, whereas the division between sacred and profane is culturally specific. Trance states, again, are not universal at all, because some religious authorities actually disapprove of deprecate trance states completely. Again, this is something very common. It's not something confined to mystics and people with special gifts like shamans. From the local to the transnational, it's a firm feature of religious activity that it can start from a very small group and extend much more widely. Some ethno-religious groups, such as the Jews, the Sikhs, the Jains, have established their diasporas. Christianity and Islam are the two religions which have had this messianic and universalizing mission throughout their history. Lastly, patina. This is something quite important, that religions become more accepted once they get old. And you could argue it takes a couple of centuries for things like Mormonism and the Baha'i to become, a century or two, to become really accepted. And this is probably the great weakness of Scientology. It has tapped into people's wanting to have a technological vocabulary that relates to the technological world, but it will never achieve this idea of a respectable age. So these are the criteria, but how does one make sense of the fact that you have some institutions which are quite obviously can be described as religious, and others which just have partake in a minor degree of the religious field? So I've tried to set out that it's as if you have these criteria which are sort of scattered from the top, where you have the strong religious field at the top with the world religions. You could argue this is begging the question, because I've set out the criteria and I'm saying, well, these are the ones that they apply to. But I would say that political ideologies like communism and Nazism that are so elaborated and follow some of these criteria so closely, if you go into them in detail, that they do actually should come into that category of a strong field religion. In the middle, you would have what I would call a medium religious field, which are movements which partake of these criteria without following all of them. Well, I'll come to this. Idea of médecins sans frontières in a moment. Then at the bottom, you would have what I would call a very weak religious field. But even here, even in the very mundane things like Rotary International, you can see that there are minor indications of these religious elements coming in. The Rotary International was founded in Chicago in 1905. The name was chosen because its members originally notated their meetings in one another's offices. They have a four-way test for professional ethics. Is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? And its motto is service above self. This was clearly devised to find a highest common factor that would unite practically oriented and ethically committed professional men, and women too, who were admitted since 1989, despite their differing positions on religious matters, so that existential issues are systematically excluded from its aims. Nonetheless, the rotary logo of the spoked cogwheel, originally a wagon wheel, now displayed in so many of the world's hotels, has arguably become itself an object of adoration. Indeed, all logos, whether designed for non-profit or for commercial purposes, may be thought of as deriving historically from basic graphic signs, including hieroglyphs and alphabetic letters that originally had a ceremonial function. The logo seeks to satisfy the consumer's thirst for a meaningful and ordered world. It may be seen, indeed, that the prevalence of logos in our time may be seen as a modern example of the idolatry against which the Jewish and Muslim prophets railed. But if we consider non-profit logos like the rotary wheel, the red poppy of the Earl Haig Fund, the Red Cross and Red Crescent, it's clear that the phenomenon is much older. It dates back to the semiotics of the cross, much older than Christianity, which originally used different symbols like the fish, then the star, the mandala, the Islamic arabesque, the pharaonic cartouche. So I would classify some of these institutions in the middle ground as having para-religious or religioid aspects, and at the bottom, one should just keep an eye open for the elements of religiosity which penetrate even everyday life in this way. Now, in the time I've got available, I'd like to say something about New Ageism, and a particular idea of a French sociologist, Raphael Liogier, that I've been quite influenced. I was influenced by in writing this book. His idea is individual globalism. This is the idea that a concern for the development of the self and the individual, what the French call a narcissism éclaté, is not in contradiction with a concern for the whole cosmos, but is in fact they are mutually interdependent, and that this is the basis of what one could call New Ageism. And this comes out in the environmental some aspects of the environmental movement, and New Age religiosity. I've got a section here on the animal rights movement, which it doesn't get quite so much publicity these days, but there was a big drama about it about 10 years ago, and people were sent to prison for very long periods. And I'd just like to say something about them. Animal rights as a para-religion. You could argue that there are some of these criteria that I've mentioned that are applicable to them. Intense and memorable conversion experiences, communities of significance, most of the adherents being atheist or agnostic, the anti-speciesist creed, which they follow, well-developed and defined codes of behavior, and cultic practices such as meetings and demonstrations. The animal rights movement dates right back to Jeremy Bentham, the founder of this university, who said in a much quoted passage that the important question to ask was not can animals reason or can they talk, but can they suffer? And curiously, there's very little reference in Christianity to animals. It's true that every sparrow that falls is supposed to be included in God's providence, even though two are sold for a farthing. But when St. Paul reminds his disciples that the Mosaic law forbids the muzzling of agricultural oxen, he says it's not for the sake of the oxen, but for the sake of the farmer. On one occasion, Jesus exorcised some devils that were tormenting one or two crazed men and transferred the devils to a herd of 2,000 swine. The Gadarene swine said they rushed down a cliff to drown in a lake. There's really very little about animal protection in the Christian Bible. It really came in the 19th century. And as we know, it's embarrassing that Hitler was introduced animal protection laws in line with his vegetarianism. But it became really a popular move. It's one of the few popular movements founded or initiated by a philosopher, Peter Singer and his followers. he had enormous influence on animal liberation. And the movement became extremely unpopular with the British establishment, people getting long sentences for sabotaging Huntington Life Sciences. This is related too with the campaign to save charismatic animal species, like the whale and the elephant, which is a related part of the movement. they're quite different from the people who are trying to blow up animal laboratories. I have a section on environmentalism, which analyzes the different kinds of environmentalism, neo-paganism, green anarchism, direct action groups, and conclude that environmentalism can be seen as a kind of para-religion. And some people have said that this has actually replaced socialism in many, many, many ways. I have a chapter on humanitarianism and looking at Médecins Sans Frontières as a faith-based organization, although it was founded by journalists. There were a few Catholics were involved, but mainly they were atheist journalists who founded it at the end of the Nigerian Civil War. But I argue that if you look at the incredible devotion to an ideal of Médecins Sans Frontières and the moral commitment of its members, and the fact that some of the young doctors who work for it as volunteers underwent conversion experiences, it can and also its preoccupation with its commitment to mitigating suffering, that it can be regarded in that light. But I want to say a bit about anthropology and archaeology in the time I've got available. It's academic cultural anthropology. I would say it's coming somewhere in the weak to medium religious field. A leading American cultural anthropologist, James Peacock, was asked to fill in a form on being admitted to hospital for surgery, and in the box marked religion, he wrote anthropology. Another, Sol Tax, who was very prominent in the 1950s and 60s, would claim that anthropology can save us. And I think Margaret Mead would have felt the same. An early 20th century British anthropologist, C.G. Seligman, used to say that fieldwork is to anthropology what the blood of the martyrs is to the church. Belonging to a relatively small discipline that only achieved professional recognition in the 20th century, anthropologists characteristically look reverentially back at their founders, who initiated a kind of apostolic succession into which new recruits can immediately fit themselves. If somebody was a student of Mary Douglas, she was a student of Evans Pritchard. That is really a very great credit. If we apply to anthropology, I'd like to apply to anthropology I expect some of you are familiar with Mary Douglas's grid group theory. You could apply to anthropologists this theory in that anthropologists tend to occupy all niches in the grid group chart. The hierarchic chart are the universities, but universities are very hierarchic institutions. But anthropology, in fact, all academic life is very individualistic because it's an international market as regards career status and publications, and hardly bounded by national frontiers in some ways, except as regards language. It is also has a tendency to what she called enclavism, of sectarian groups who speak in small groups to themselves with charismatic leaders. And lastly, there are the isolates. There are dedicated individuals on the fringe who don't actually belong to any particular groups, maybe doing quite exciting work, but are what she would call isolates. So now you could argue this applies to all academic life, but I think it particularly applies to anthropology. Of course, anthropology has this popularizing side, which is has been an asset in the past, but also a bugbear in some ways. The evangelical style that was popularized by Margaret Mead and Sol Tax, who I mentioned, is now deeply unfashionable within the discipline. Margaret Mead was a household name of particularly forceful personality who was always prepared to opine publicly on anything to do of public interest. In Britain, we had a brief period of successful popularization during the 70s and 80s, when a series of outstanding films, ethnographic films, was brought to a large public. And Mead was not the only anthropologist to achieve sanctification by the media. Lévi-Strauss became the supreme being of European anthropology, complemented by attendant sub-deities such as Edmund Leach and Mary Douglas, and a host of prophets and apostles, and some colorful heretics, such as Ernest Gellner, who described himself as an Enlightenment fundamentalist. Now, I think we may think of these prominent personalities as like the sculptures on the outer porch of a great cathedral such as Chartres. But as time goes by, some of these images become difficult to identify for the average pilgrim, while the stone begins to crumble. Actually, I think less for Mary Douglas than for many of the others. I think she's one of the people whose reputation is still holding up very strongly. The work of devotion is carried on inside, but the cathedral is too ambitious in scale for modern times, and we find that worshippers are more comfortable inside chapels that give a sense of intimacy. This is the domain of the indoor cult figures of present-day anthropology. Their contribution to knowledge has been at least as great as that of the outdoor figures, but is consulted more discreetly. But so much for social cultural anthropology. But leading up to what I want to say about Chris, I'd now like to say something about archaeology and paleoanthropology. Because archaeology has been haunted by the study of suffering in the prehistoric past. The deaths of individuals, because it's graves and tombs are so much the stock in trade of the archaeologist, but also the deaths of cultures and the fact that experimental work is impossible. W.H. Auden, in his poem Archaeology, alludes to the discipline's exploration of graves, urban disasters, volcanic eruptions, floods, and human hordes, agog for slaves and glory. It's true that we have records of the happier aspects of prehistoric life, such as games and sports, music and dancing, intimate family scenes, but these are mainly from civilizations such as that of ancient Egypt, where much pictorial and carved material has survived. There's also the archaeology, what I call the archaeology of reverie, that was debunked by Glyn Daniel, who wrote about bullshit archaeology rather rudely, Stuart Piggott and Peter Ucko. Professional archaeology has set out to try to insulate itself from New Ageism, but its New Ageism is still very strong. One thinks of Stonehenge and Chichen Itza in Mexico, which are Celtic pilgrimage sites. So professional archaeology has become a kind of scientific laboratory built unwittingly over an ancient pilgrimage site where spirits roam by moonlight and peddlers of amulets and elixirs ply their trade by day. Ian Hodder, I think very laudably, has been more hospitable in declining to dismiss or patronize this this interest in archaeology. For instance, the mother goddess interpretations of female figurines found in Anatolia in about 10,000 BC. And Gimbutas, what was her name? Marija Gimbutas, who wrote about the mother goddess, been completely debunked by modern anthropologists. I think her views would have been almost orthodox some years ago before carbon dating came in. I'd like to mention a couple of paleoanthropologists who in their day were very prominent. I wonder if I could take a poll here. How many people know about Teilhard de Chardin here? A few, but not very many. And Lauren Isley? Nobody for Lauren Isley. Well, I'll just say something about them, but this leads on to Chris Knight, when I have a section here, Chris Knight draws down the moon. Pierre Teilhard de Chardin was a native of Auvergne in southern France, and he has an honorable place in the history of paleoanthropology. He played a major part in important expeditions in China and Mongolia and was one of the first to predict that the Rift Valley in East Africa would be the site of some of the oldest hominid fossils to be discovered. He's also remembered for his determination as a Jesuit priest to continue his scientific work despite the firm opposition of the Vatican in his day to all evolutionary studies. He wasn't allowed to publish during his lifetime, and he had to return. He was a Jesuit. He was told by the Society of Jesus to go to spend his. He wasn't allowed to return to France. He had to spend his last days in America. He was accused of imminent pantheism and denying the truth of original sin. And his best-known book, The Phenomenon of Man, very well known in its day, was published posthumously. His philosophical position was an extension or interpretation of Darwinism, but not to be confused with creationism or intelligent design. He believed that evolution would proceed progressively to new dimensions of complexity in which the material and the spiritual would be fused, and he called this the noosphere. Humans participate in the process of cosmogenesis, and the awareness of this process that Darwinism made possible opened up for him new horizons for further evolution towards an eventual omega point, which is identified with the God of Christianity. Now, his reputation was completely destroyed by one of the most ruthless book reviews ever published by Peter Medawar in 1961, who said that this was pure philosophy fiction and was really catering for a market in the cheap dailies and weeklies. He still has an international following, led by Teilhard Appreciation Societies in the United States, France, and Britain, and he's been reaccepted by the Catholics, but completely marginalized from anthropology. His misfortune was perhaps that of intellectual isolation. He was trying to speak to two different audiences, the religious and the scientific, without the benefit of informed criticism and feedback from scientists. But some of his ideas are finding perhaps a renewed vigor, for instance, when related to the Gaia hypothesis, or to current thinking about the future of the internet and cyberspace as a realization of what he called the noosphere. And a continued new age following does seem to be assured. Now, Lauren Isley, of whom seems nobody here has heard, was in his day quite an important figure in the United States. He wrote an excellent book about precursors of Darwin in the early 19th century. He qualified in anthropology, spent most of his career in the anthropology department of the University of Pennsylvania, was awarded 36 honorary degrees and many other scholarly distinctions. In the days of his prime, American anthropology covered the whole study of humanity. He was best known to the public for a series of occasional essays loosely based on archaeology and biology, and strongly reminiscent of Thoreau's transcendentalism. A typical one is called The Angry Winter, a meditation which opens with the author working by his fireside amid the debris of a far greater winter, on the lance points of Ice Age hunters and the heavy leg bone of a fossil bison, while the windows of his house are shaken by a blizzard. His beloved sheepdog, Wolf, picks up one of the bones in his mouth and begins to defend it with fierce snarls, like the ancestor he's named after, while at the same time imploring his master not to try to force him to give it up. The author distracts Wolf by inviting him to walk in the snow, and Wolf makes up for his aggression by frolicking and then leading him back to the shelter of the house. The author reflects on the mystery of human beings' emergence at the end of recurrent glaciations. Urban man still lives at the mercy of giant destructive forces and has magnified the powers of the natural world himself. We're probably now in the middle of an interglacial summer, but it's open to us to discern a universe in a spider's web or a galaxy in a swarm of summer midges. The truly perceptive man must know that where the human eye stops and hearing terminates, there still vibrates an inconceivable and spectral world of which we learn only through devised instruments. He went out of fashion in the 70s, I would say, when he was a great master of the radio talk, the inspiring radio talk, which fell out of fashion. And there's still a Lauren Isley Appreciation Society. I think even there's an Appreciation Society formed by people, it means that they probably have fallen out of fashion and might not come back. But leading on from those two, I'd now like to come to Chris, because this is the passage that he was kind enough to say he approved of, and I think the best thing is I just read it.
I might have second thoughts.
I've got 10 minutes. One anthropologist deserves special attention because he combines scientific sophistication with conscious myth-making. Most cultural anthropologists today, by contrast with earlier, less specialized generations, show little interest in trying to establish the prehistoric origins of humanity. They find enough to interest them in contemporary human societies, brimming not only with data to be collected, but also with living people to question and to interact with. Chris Knight, Professor of Anthropology in the University of East London, is an exception, a cultural anthropologist whose main interest is the evolutionary emergence of language, kinship, art, ritual, and religion. He's developed a highly original and imaginative, indeed surprising model, which though it has not been proved to be valid, has not been refuted. It's an ingenious amalgam of the dialectical materialism of Marx, the social anthropology of Lévi-Strauss and Mary Douglas, intellectual feminism associated with such authors as Donna Haraway, and neo-Darwinism. His major book, Blood Relations, published in 1991, has required some time to be taken seriously by anthropologists. Its argument may be summarized as the sex strike model. One of Knight's starting points is the intriguing convergence in human beings between the lunar month, approximately 28 days, and the menstrual cycle, which is on average about the same. It used to be thought that there was a close connection, possibly deriving from our aquatic ancestors, between the rhythm of the tides, which was certainly controlled by the movement of the moon in conjunction with the sun, and that of menstruation. However, this seems unlikely because the duration of the menstrual cycle in our fairly close relative, the chimpanzee, is 37 days rather than the average 28 days. Coincidence is more likely, but many mythological sources assume a close connection. Human females, by contrast with most other species, are distinctive in giving no external signs that they are sexually receptive. According to Knight's sex strike model, females capitalize on this convergence to control their own sexuality and use it as a means to negotiate with males to bring home meat from the hunt, which was likely to be most successful by a waxing moon. Every month after the new moon, they withdrew from sexual contact, synchronizing their infertile periods in order to protect one another, procure adequate supplies of high-energy food, and establish the nurturing, stable environment that human infants need in order to survive. Moreover, they used red ochre, which is widely found in archaeological sites, to scramble menstrual signals by painting their bodies, concealing who was imminently fertile and who was not, with the aim of motivating other dominant males to invest in their partners and offspring rather than indulge in opportunistic philandering. Women engaged in ritual dances, both to dramatize their solidarity and to remind men of the rewards awaiting them if they return successfully from the hunt. They dressed up as animals and or males in an inversion of normal courting rituals. Hence emerged a wide range of ritual behaviors documented in the ethnographic record, and indeed the whole repertoire of human symbolism and language, which is thus intimately linked to deception. Women also took control of cooking through forcing men to hand over meat, dramatizing the distinction which Lévi-Strauss has seen as the epitome of culture dominating nature, the distinction between raw and cooked food. Knight and his associates have drawn on an impressive body of ethnographic and archaeological evidence, whose result has been to dazzle rather than win over most of their colleagues. For they claim to have set out no less than an integrated model of the origins of kinship, language, religions, and art. In Popperian style, they call on colleagues to produce evidence that would falsify the model, such as evidence of pre-hunt as opposed to post-hunt rituals, prescribing indulgence in marital sex. By contrast, most cultural anthropologists today shy away from advancing falsifiable theories. As a convinced radical socialist, Knight is determined to oppose the conservative contention that human nature, being fixed and prone to aggressive excess, needs to be kept in check by rules and regulations externally imposed. Whereas most archaeologists believe that there was a cognitive revolution at some point in time to make possible such achievements as language and sophisticated tool manufacture, Knight contends that the momentous transition to mind, language, and symbolic culture must also have been a political revolution. If there was a benign feminist revolution once at the dawn of prehistory, around 70,000 years ago, there can be one again. Knight's position is that his work is both objective science, meeting at least as high a standard of explanatory power as that demanded of more orthodox anthropological and archaeological research, and also a salutary narrative or myth. Having absorbed the lesson of Marx and Freud that what presents itself as objective social theory usually conceals unexamined values, he prefers to wear his heart on his sleeve. Whereas social anthropologists, despite their admiration for his ingenuity, often claim that Knight's comparative method is too eclectic, evolutionary biologists have problems with what they see as the teleological aspect of his thinking. As one commentator puts it, quote, while Kipling in his Just So stories, in imagining the origins of the alphabet, projects the bourgeois family back into our prehistory, Knight sends the striker, the feminist, and the political militant back into the past, unquote. Others point out that the antinomian counterculture of the 1960s has lost out to rampant hyperconsumerism, so that in the words of one reviewer of Blood Relations, quote, the conditions for a sex strike in late 20th century America are as remote as a doctor's strike for a rational healthcare system. We did have a junior doctor's strike here. However, Knight reposts that the coming environmental crisis may well create new conditions for political revolution. Knight is an atheist, but he was brought up as a Catholic, and unlike many others working in his field, never underestimates the power of the religious inclination. While disavowing any New Age credentials, he's a sympathetic witness to annual solstice celebrations at Stonehenge and the nearby Neolithic monuments at Avebury, and he has certainly attracted some degree of New Age following. For he has turned on his head the conventional view that culture was created by males, rearticulating the 19th century theory of primitive matriarchy, which orthodox 20th century anthropology claimed to have totally exploded. No wonder his work resonates with contemporary feminist spirituality, goddess worship, and eco-druidism. It's a remarkable mixture of erudite science and mythopoeic narrative, mediated by enthusiasm and humour. Blood Relations has been aptly called a slow-burning classic. It stands to the early 21st century as Théod de Chardin and Isley did to the 20th, which is why I brought them in, in setting out to develop a humanistic ethic compatible with Darwinism rather than parasitic on theological doctrine. It's a convincing and timely expression of individual globalism at a sophisticated intellectual level.
Well, I could live with that.
As I've just got 5 minutes more, I'd just like to say something about the last section of my book. I say something about contemporary China, which is obviously the future of ideology in contemporary China is something of enormous importance to the world. And I argue that in four of the neighboring countries to China, religion is in different ways very important. India, obviously. Japan, perhaps less in a more diffuse kind of way, but still you have the emperor is still pretty important there. And there's a lot of ritual activity, a sort of diffused religiosity. Thailand, obviously, where the late king was almost a kind of bodhisattva. And Indonesia, where you have the ideology of Pancasila, and obviously religion is important. Whereas in communist China, tried to extirpate religion, but substituted the cult of Mao, which was in a very, very strict sense, a para-religious ideology. I mean, people used to. The devotion to Mao was something that dominated people's lives. They would have conversations with his portrait in their flat when they left it to go to work. Then in the middle of the day there would be discussion sessions about. Then they would go home to give a report on their day to Mao, and then you had the effervescence of the Cultural Revolution and the Little Red Book and so forth. Then that was all completely taken away from people, so the rug was pulled under people's feet with the prosecution of the Gang of Four and the rise of Deng Xiaoping and of a kind of state capitalism. So I argue that whereas Marxism says that religion is a veil to obscure the realities of capital appropriation, what you have in China is Marxism has become a veil, communism has become a veil to obscure the fact that it's become extremely capitalistic. And what you're left is the rule of the party state. And since I wrote this book, I think the rise of the present supreme ruler of China you now have a personality cult of him. You have He has eliminated any kind of opposition. He's changed the constitution so that he has an unlimited period of office, whereas there was a new rule brought in, I think, after Deng Xiaoping, so that nobody would have an unlimited tenure like Mao Zedong. That has all been changed. And so-called Xi thought has been actually made part of the constitution, as in this, on the same level as of Mao Zedong thought. So you in fact have the party state trying to control religion, because there's a rise of religiosity, particularly Christianity and the house churches and so on. So and trying to actually control religion, and now it's becoming obligatory for members of the party to become official atheists. They realize that they can't extirpate religion, and they, in the case of Islam, it's valuable to them to have links with the Middle East for commercial reasons, but they wanted to keep under tight control. There's an excellent book by Matthew Airy on Muslims in China, which points out this antinomy between the rule of the party state and the 20 million or maybe 40 million or so Muslims in China. And so that it actually bears out some of the arguments I was making in the book with particular relevance today. Thank you.